everyone. So like Rajiv was saying, I spoke about the similar topic last time, and it's a continuation with a few more examples. So the question of how do we know what we know of Indian history or epistemology of Indian history, the reason why it's very interesting for me is that it's not just important to know what happened in the past, but how is it that the historians who are writing the history are reconstructing the past. The way we do that is, any historians would do that is basically look at resources, the primary sources. It could be archaeological sources or literary evidences, manuscripts, bunch of things. And that's how they reconstruct the past. So when I started probing this question to whatever things that I was doing, whatever I was reading, so I got more curious and I want to know how they have reconstructed the past. And as I went about looking at primary sources, I had a different understanding of the past. I was probably in most cases not in, I was not agreeing with what the historians were talking about. So, just before I start, I want to apologize, though I make a living making presentations, my presentation today would be very lazy. let me start off with a question. What's the earliest evidence that we know of writing in Indian history? Close, but yeah, Harappan script. So it's the Indus script. So we're not sure if that's really, that can be really called a script. But hopefully, it's got some symbols and it tends to move towards script. But sadly, the Harappan script has so far not been deciphered. So then, what's the oldest deciphered script in India?
Brahmi and Tamil.
Yeah, so Brahmi, yeah. I mean, we'll argue that later, like the Brahmi, Tamil, Brahmi, inscriptions, bunch of things. So yeah, anyway. So it's the Brahmi, that's the oldest script that has been deciphered. It's done by James Princip during 1850s. So there are a lot of people who are working on trying to decipher this script. They found these inscriptions of Ashoka lying around the country. They didn't know what these inscriptions meant. So just lying there, and a lot of people tried making sense out of it. They couldn't. Finally comes James Princip. He was lucky to find a hoard of Greek coins. Greek rulers were ruling in the northwest part of the country, and he looked at these coins, and because the coins had, they were bilingual coins, which means they had Greek or Aramaic, and then on one side mentioning the name of the king, and then you would have the same thing written in Brahmi on the other side. So that's how it completely deciphered the script, and then suddenly people are able to read the Ashokan inscriptions that are around the country. So my question then was like, how do we know that the script is called Brahmi? So we've looked at Rosetta Stone that helped decipher Egyptian hieroglyphics. Similarly, Behistun inscription, which was again a bilingual inscription that helped decipher the Mesopotamian cuneiform script. Why didn't the Britishers call it by some other name? Why did they call it Brahmi? How do we know that the script was called Brahmi? Is there some place where I can see that this script in which I'm writing is called Brahmi? Unfortunately, there's no such script. There's no such place where they say that the script is written in Brahmi. I'll come to a bit more details later. So then I dug out like, how is it that they started calling this script a Brahmi? We'll have to look at a couple of sources. So a lot of people who, I looked at multiple secondary sources, and from there I went finding the actual source. There are two ways in which, there are two sources that on which historians rely to identify the script as Brahmi. So this is from a text called Lalita Vistara. So this is written somewhere around 350 AD. It's kind of a hagiography of Buddha and Bodhisattvas. So here is a, it's from chapter 10 where Buddha is taken to school. The school is a script, school where they teach different kinds of script. So then the teacher Vishwamitra is like, Buddha, what do I teach you? You know everything, you know the Veda, blah, blah, blah. And then Buddha then answers to him, what is the writing, sir, which you wish to teach me? Is it the Brahmi writing or the Karoshti or the Pushkarasi? And he goes on to list 64 scripts in this one passage. So we, from this we do know that around 350 AD there were around 64 scripts that were being used in India. Yeah. So this is one evidence there I found that Brahmi as a script was mentioned, and it was mentioned in the very beginning. So then comes another Chinese text called Fa Yun Zhuling. I think I pronounced it correctly. So this is a text that like lots of things keep getting added to the text, but we do have a version that's from 668 AD, and in this particular text where they talk about the scripts that are being used in India. So the author says that there are a couple of scripts in India. He lists like a bunch of scripts, and then he says there's one script called Brahmi, and it's written from right to left, and then there's something called Karoshti that's written from right to left. And this is like a this is random evidence somewhere which says that there is this some script that's written from left to right. So based on these two references, historians have identified that the first script was called Brahmi, which is written from left to right. I don't completely agree with the reasoning behind this, couple of reasons. So this is a 668 AD text, and Lalita Vistara is 350. Ashoka's inscriptions are 250 BC. So it's almost 500 years have elapsed since there's first evidence of Brahmi script in Lalita Vistara. So, and I mean, it just says that Karoshti is written from right to left. Right? But that doesn't mean the one that's written from left to right is Brahmi in all the cases, because we've got a bunch of other scripts that are mentioned. It could be either of this. Just because we are able to identify Karoshti, that doesn't mean because we have Brahmi in the first place, that kind of script is called Brahmi. So it's very dicey. And I looked at several sources where people have books on Indian epigraphy, and all of them base their reasoning on Indian paleography written by G. Buller. So just looking at what Buller was writing there, and then he says, even he's not sure that the script is Brahmi. He says, these traditional statements made it advisable to adopt the designation Brahmi for the characters in which majority of the Ashokan edicts are written. So he himself was not sure that the script is called Brahmi. So this is one example, and talk about it later. So then the other question is, how did modern historians recognize that there was a ruler called Ashoka? Very interesting again when you look at it. So when Brahmi script was deciphered, lots of Ashoka's edicts got deciphered. But anybody who's looked at Ashoka inscriptions would say that there's nowhere that Ashoka is mentioned in the inscription. It just says Devanam Piya Piya Dasi, which is the beloved of the god Piya Dasi. So a lot of historians were like curious, who is Piya Dasi, who is Devanam Piya Piya Dasi was. Much later, there's another text called Deepa Vamsa. It's a text, Buddhist text from Sri Lanka. The book talks about how Buddhism came into Sri Lanka, carried by Mahinda, Ashoka's son, and his daughter. Sangamitta. So that's where we get to know. I mean, the book talks about Ashoka, and there it interchangeably uses the word Devanam Piya Piya Dasi, Ashoka, Ashoka Dhamma, Ashoka Raja. So these are four different names that are used interchangeably. So that's how we get to know that Devanam Piya Piya Dasi was Ashoka. Ashokan inscriptions keep getting discovered one day or the other. So there's one place called Maski, which is close to Raichur in Karnataka. So there they found an inscription which actually mentions the word Ashoka in it. So it talks about the entire inscription is like Devanam Piya Piya Dasi Ashoka Raja. So Maski inscription kind of confirms the belief that Devanam Piya Piya Dasi was actually Ashoka. And later there was another inscription from place near Jhansi in Madhya Pradesh. It's called Gujara inscription. Even there, Devanam Piya Piya Dasi Ashoka Raja is mentioned again. So it kind of confirms, because they are Deepa Vamsa, the text on which people have relied to say that Piya Dasi was Ashoka, is actually a text that gets written 500 years after Ashoka's life. So till then it was like kind of dicey, but much later they kind of zeroed that it's actually Ashoka. Yeah, if you want to look at translation of the Akkadic. This other trivia I'll probably talk about later.